Okay, we can start. Good morning, my brothers and sisters. All of you who are students and priests of the Sabbath from Sunset Friday to Sunset Sabbath, I got to believe that you slept better last night than you do any other day of the week. I slept very well, even though I only got 5 hours sleep. But there's something about the Sabbath. Something about the Sabbath that causes all of our body parts and our minds to relax, because we believe as Seventh-day Adventists that the Sabbath is a day of rest, and a rest from all of our work. And yet we can praise God and rest in Jesus Christ. Amen. This is a very important Sabbath for us today. Some of you may or may not know that this is our final Sabbath here at 3-1. And Bonnie and I just want, Yvonne and I just want you to know that the 2 years we've been here have been special. We have grown because of you. Yes. You have loved us and you taught us to love you back. Yes. And so we want you to know that while this is the last day, this does not by any means mean out of sight, out of mind. Mm-hmm. I can take the 5, but I don't have to come in on the 15. And I can stay away from the church. I know where the Cheesecake Factory is and other places of import for food. We plan to always fellowship with you. And so today, we just ask that you will pray in your hearts for us as we fellowship, as we say so long, but not goodbye. Mm-hmm. And as we go through this day, may we reflect on the time that we've had and the time that we're going to have in the earth made new, where we can just have Oakwood alumni weekend forever. Through eternity. That's our prayer. Today we have a special message for you and for us, and I pray that the Holy Spirit will speak to you. And now at this time, we want to welcome Sister Yvonne Kilby. I believe she has some information for you. Sister Yvonne.
Good morning, church family. How are you? It's good to see you. And welcome guests, if you're visiting with us for the first time. And if you are revisiting us again, thank you. This is my last Sabbath. This is my last birthday, and happy birthdays and happy anniversaries to our members of the church. So for the birthdays for March, we celebrated Jalecia Johnson. Her birthday was on the 4th. Johnny Richards, her birthday was on the 5th. Jasmine Johnson, her birthday was on the 7th. Marjorie Hannon, her birthday was on the 14th. Jolene Lee, her birthday was on the 16th. Kelly Carter, birthday was on the 18th. Ernestine Pittman and Mildred Center, their birthday was on the 19th. Mary Johnson, her birthday is today. Happy birthday, Mary. Rita Ansley, her birthday is on the 28th. And Stephen Gooden, his birthday is on the 30th. And for the anniversaries of this month, on March 7th was Harmon and Annie Bounds' anniversary. I want to say happy birthday, belated and upcoming birthdays. May you be blessed. Be well and be safe. And now our intercessory prayer will be given to us by Elder Al Johnson.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, saints. It's good to see you all as much as possible. It's a beautiful Sabbath day. It's kind of a bittersweet day. And I just hope everyone is doing well right now. We have a few people on our our sick and shut-in list that I want to present right now. There's quite a few there, and we need to continue to keep them in prayer. We have Mary Johnson. We have Courtney Lawrence, Candida Corral, Granderson Phelps III, Enrique and Olivia Ramirez, Lynn Ruff, Catherine Armstrong, Hugo Daly, Ira Eccles, Evelyn Johnson, Gloria Johnson, Katie Protho, Edna Robinson, Fred Todd, and Sandra West. We also have prayers for families and friends. And on that list, we have Leah Robinson, Jolanda Cochran West, Gordon Martinborough, Ishmael Adonius, who is on life support, Jacqueline Hodges, Eric Shipton, Clarence E. Hodges Sr., Jessiana Henry, she's a godniece of Nola Bryant, and she needs a liver transplant. Lily Moore, she's the cousin of Margie Hannon, who had heart surgery, continue to keep her in prayer. Elder Gerald Pennick, Delilah Aguilar, Thomas Harris, who is a brother of David Smith, and Pastor Callie Williams. We need to also keep in prayer Elder Velma Brown. She's lost her daughter-in-law, Juanita Pullins. And as well, she just recently lost her sister, Shelby Haywood. Keep in prayer also Sister Nola Bryant. She's lost her niece, Janice Grant. And Brother Rico Moore, he's recently lost his mother. There's been so much going on right now in this world. And so things are getting better in the name of Jesus. I just hope and pray that we just continue to always keep them first and foremost in all that we say and do and keep our heads to the sky for him. So now, right now, let's go in and bow our heads and pray wherever you are. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we come to you now, Lord, because you are a faithful God, Lord. You are a all-wise, Lord, a all-knowing, all-seeing God, Father. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us, Lord. Father, you loved us so much that you gave us your only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Through faith in Jesus Christ, Father. Lord, we thank you so much for waking us this morning, Father, from out of our sleep, Father. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Lord, we thank you for our health and our strength, our right minds, Father. We thank you, Lord, for keeping us out of harm's way, Father. Lord, there's so many people on our sick and shut-in list, and many family members are needing a prayer right now, Father. We just pray that you would just go by, Lord, and just touch each and every one of them, Lord. Heal them, Father. Remove anything that's within them that's not supposed to be there, Father. Anything, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we just pray that you will continue to forgive us, Lord, of all of our sins, our shortcomings, and our iniquities. Lord, and on this day, Lord, we come to you kind of with somber hearts, Father, this morning, because we know that you sent us a pastor, an interim pastor, Pastor Kilby. And we thank you for him, Lord. He has been a tremendous leader, Father, a preacher, a teacher, Father, a mentor, a guide for us all, Father. We thank you so much for him, Lord. We thank you for sending his wife as well, Father. We pray now, Lord, that you will be with both of them, Lord, wherever they go, Lord. And we know that you know that you will send them places where there's a need for them. And Lord, as with us here, they will bless them tremendously, Father. We thank you, Father, for them so very much, Lord. Lord, I pray that you will bless him as he presents the word for us today, Lord, that that all within earshot of him may receive a Holy Spirit-filled blessing. Lord, bless him as he presents the word today to all of us, Father. We pray, Lord, that we continue to move, Lord, this day forward, keeping you first and foremost in all of our thoughts, our prayers, Lord, and that we give you all the honor, the glory, and the praise, Lord, for this is my prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now we're going to have our tithes and offerings presented to you by Deacon Kevin Parrish.
Happy Sabbath, saints. Praise the Lord for his continued blessings. In this time of our service, it's time for us to return our tithes and offering to the Lord. I just want to share a scripture with you, just for a brief moment. 2 Corinthians 9:7. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give thoughtfully and with purpose, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. We have three ways which you can actually contribute, one being online through Advent Giving. Go to the website at www.31sda.org and select the donate button, and then select Give Now. Also, you can mail in your tithes and offerings to the church directly, 31st Street, Seventh-day Adventist Church, 414 South 31st Street, San Diego, California, 92113. Or on Sabbath between the hours of 1 p.m. and 3, you can drop off your tithes and offerings to one of the deacons here at the church. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your eternal blessings and your mercies. You have given us so much. As we return a portion of what you have given us, Lord, let us use this humble offering as you see fit to hasten your second coming. Lord, I ask that you bless those who are able to give and those who are not. Thank you for your continued blessings. In the name of your son, Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
The next two voices you will hear, Pastor Edwards, Vice President of Black Ministries. And then after him, you will hear a musical blessing by Joe and Elena Freitas of Hawaii.
Well, hello, members and friends who are here for this occasion. This is one of those happy, sad moments where it can be difficult, but yet we can rejoice. I go back to my search for an interim pastor for 31st Street, and I remember praying and seeking and making phone calls. And I called this one pastor who I was asking, could you be an interim pastor? And that pastor said, you know what? I would love to do that. He said, but I know somebody who actually would be better than me. And I was asking who? And he said, my partner in crime at the university, Dr. Shelton Kilby. I said, wait a minute. I mean, we go way back. When I say way back, you know, of course, that's when I was a kid. He was still grown. But we go way back. And so it was like, you know what? I hadn't thought that because we didn't see each other much. Occasionally run into each other in the grocery store. So I called him and I spoke with him. I said, listen, Doc, I need someone who, you know, could come into this church and fulfill certain responsibilities. And he prayed about it, and we came to the conclusion that he was the person. But then he brought an added blessing. He had his lovely wife, Yvonne, who is a consummate pastor's wife. And the two of them came in, and from day one, she became a sister, a mother, a friend, a mentor, a first lady. I mean, just stepped in with a lovely smile and joined in with everyone else. And together the two of them have worked here, and they remind me of this, the six words that I saw in Esther. And those six words were, for such a time as this, for such a time as this. And I have to tell you, being a supervisor, that it is always a blessing when pastors or go to a church and members hate to see them leave. I hate to do a farewell for someone that the church wants to say farewell to. But this is not that occasion. This is one of those that makes it a struggle and makes it very difficult. But as I stated before, those six words, we brought him in for such a time as this. And I expected nothing less than for him to fall in love with you and you fall in love with him. And I appreciate what the two of them have done, especially what he has done as a leader, a visionary. I think he is leaving it in a tremendous shape and condition. And we want him to know on behalf of the conference that we appreciate you fulfilling what you are asked to do. And I can reassure you all that he's already allocated, selected, appointed, anointed, and they have been giving a new charge to help us here in Southeastern California Conference, not just in Black ministries, but in the conference as a whole. So 31st Street, thank you for the way that you accepted them, ingratiated them, and made them feel as though they are a part of the family. I can attest to that, that once you've been bitten by 3-1, you're already contaminated. They will always be your family, no matter what. And I appreciate that about the church. So I want to thank the church for the way that they have engulfed you and your lovely wife. And I know they're going to miss you, but you will always be in their hearts and they will always be in yours. They're just habit forming. I just want you to know that, okay? And so, in behalf of the conference, once again, Black Ministries, as well as Sandy and the other officers, thank you for doing such a wonderful, I can't use the word job because it was ministry, for doing such a wonderful ministry. And Sister Yvonne, thank you so much, because I don't know what he would have been without you. Lord, have mercy. So thank you for controlling the mute button. So God bless you. And so in behalf of my wife and I, we want to say thank you. We love you. And we look forward to your continual ministry. Let's give him a hand. Give him a hand. And now I think we're going to have special music. Thank you so much once again.
Yes. Aloha and happy Sabbath. You know, I must say that 31st Street has been such a blessing to my family and to my ohana. We went a couple summers ago looking for a church. And, you know, I'm scared to say this, but I went to some Adventist churches in the SD area. And some of them didn't give me the time of day. And I was discouraged. Then I finally walked to the doors of 31st, and I got hugged 7 times before I sat down. And I said, I'm home. I'm home. Pastor Kilby was there. In fact, I met so many people. Blessing. Well, last summer was the first summer we hadn't gone to SD in 20 years. And we missed you guys. And since then, I have this thing called rheumatoid arthritis, which makes it tough to play. But as long as the Lord gives me a breath, I'm going to play and I'm going to sing. And I tell you, 31st Street is on my mind. My daughter would be here, but she's spending the day with a friend who's going to San Diego tomorrow. And a week ago, I saw Angie P. Because she goes to 31st, but she's back in Hilo. And I'm like, you know, 31st is just calling to me. And then finally, on Thursday, I had a girl fly in, this young woman. She flew in, and she was visiting our island for the day. And she's sitting in the car, socially distanced. And I went down to visit this young lady. And I said, hello, who are you? And she goes, yeah. And her name was Angela. No, not Angela. I can't get her name right now. Well, anyway, the main thing was, I said, "Oh, I think I knew your dad from PUC." And I said, "Where are you teaching?" She goes, "I teach at El Cajon Seventh-day Adventist Church." And I said, "El Cajon?" I said, "Do you know Pendeza? Pendeza?" She goes, "Yes." I met the teacher that teaches with Pendeza on Thursday at my little school in Hilo. You know, 31st is just coming at waves to us. And so this summer, hopefully we can make it. But man, I'm going to have to hunt Pastor Kilby down in Riverside. I got to come because you guys have been giving love, and I just want to praise the name of Jesus. So I'll stop talking. I will always praise the name of Jesus. In his name, my sins are washed away. I'm free. Other names will be forgotten, but his name will last forever. It remains the same through all eternity. And will always be the song for me. The name of Jesus, that sweet name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, there is life today. Soon the gates will open up to heaven. In my home, I'm going to see my Savior's face. And then I'll know he's the same as the one who bore that name when he humbly walked among the human race. At the cross on Calvary, we saw his grave. Name of Jesus, that sweet name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, there is life today. Name of Jesus, that sweet name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, there is life today. There is life today in that name. Praise the Lord. Happy Sabbath from Hawaii. Aloha, Pastor Kilby. God bless.
The name of Jesus, there is life today. I believe that. I wish that I relished the name of Jesus when I was a teenager, thinking that that was all of that in a bag of chips. But now when I look back on my life and see what God has done in my life, he's enriched me with a beautiful wife. He's enriched me with a gentlemen and ladies that I know in the ministry. He's enriched me and my wife with the pleasure and the opportunity of serving 31st Street.
Amen.
It has Amen. Just been, you know, time flies when you're having fun.
Well, yes.
And we've been having fun. Often, some of you would say to me, "Well, I hate that you have to make that drive." And they probably didn't hear the sermon that I preached early on, that I enjoy Interstate 15. It's a beautiful ride. And when I'm riding down 15, cruising at 80 miles an hour with the traffic, with Miles Davis playing his trumpet, I can't ask for anything more than that. Only heaven is better than that.
Well,
amen.
So it has been a joy for both of us. To my friend and colleague, my vice president, Elder Edwards, I guess we were destined to be thrown together because his last name is my middle name. Uh-huh. That means he's older than I am. Oh, he got here before I did. But we've known each other for a lot of years, he and Denise, and God has blessed us both in the ministry. And I want to say to him and to thank him for the opportunity to serve, for letting God use you, knowing that we needed what 3-1 had to offer.
Amen.
And that is prayer. I had a preacher to call me and say to me, all you got to do is love 3-1 and they'll love you back.
Amen.
And so you know what? That is true. And I praise God for it.
Mm-hmm.
I want to thank my good friend, Elder Al Johnson. I call him the quiet giant. You know, Al walks in the room and just sucks up all the oxygen when he comes in. He just has that way about him. That's the way he carries himself. And it's been a pleasure to work with he and Regina, only to find out when I got here that Regina was from South Central Conference. Yeah. And I started, well, my second conference was South Central. And so I often did Sabbath school workshops down at her church. So, you know, it's a small world. I can imagine what it's going to be like when we get to heaven. I thinking of the words of the celebrated theologian from England, Charles Spurgeon, who said that joy is the soul of praise.
Yes.
And when we delight ourselves in God, we lift him up. Mm-hmm. For he is such a God, our God, which should wake within us an unceasing and overflowing joy. For rejoicing in self is foolish. Rejoicing in sin is fatal. Mm-hmm. But rejoicing in God is heavenly.
Amen.
And he who would have a double heaven must first worship below like those above.
Amen.
So thank you again for Elder Edwards. And this morning I have a message that God has given to me, for me, and for you. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Isaiah, and we're going to look at chapter 62, verse 5. Chapter 62, verse 5. Isaiah 62, verse 5. For as a young man marries a virgin, so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. As the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you.
Amen.
This morning I want to preach a different kind of sermon. It is almost a metaphor, and I pray that you will be blessed by it. Let us pray. Correction, and the title of the sermon that I want to speak on today is Sign the Katiba. Correction, sign the ketubah. It's a Hebrew word. So turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
I need to sign the ketubah.
I need to sign the ketubah.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord God of the universe, at this moment, we ask that you will remove my spirit from my body and that you will take up residence in this body. And at the name of Jesus, all of us will be affected because of his love, because of his wisdom, because of his affection for us, and because of the price he paid at Calvary for us. May you be seen and heard, dear Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everyone say amen.
Amen.
And amen. I am always amazed at the ritual of wedding preparation. The bride is usually consumed for years with the style of her wedding gown one day. Perhaps the length of its train or the cut of the dress, the sleeves, the waist, the neckline, or what color white, or before there, all of this is before a man is worthy of marrying her. Then there is the wedding party. How many bride attendants and how many male escorts will there be? And oh, let us not forget the music, whether it should be pop or traditional. And surely the wedding rings, will they be silver, gold, or bling? Or will they be simply an understated elegance in all of its finery? Then there is something in some weddings called the prenup or the prenuptial contract to be signed before the wedding ceremony. This contract is about protecting one's money or financial empire of wealth, just in case the marriage does not work. This is usually the manner in which most Western Christians prepare for their life long-awaited dream or fantasy. This is the usual Christian contract. However, the Jewish wedding is totally different. There is no wedding contract, but there is something called the wedding covenant. The name of this covenant is called the ketubah. According to Mark Eileen Quinnan, the rabbi or person conducting the wedding ceremony puts before the bride and groom a marriage deed, the ketubah. Literally, the word ketubah means that which is written, an abbreviation of the expression written commitment. The ketubah, which is incorrectly translated as a marriage contract, is in fact a divorce insurance. It guarantees that in the event of an official separation, the husband will give the wife enough money to live on for several years. For however much time it takes for her to find a stable situation, it is a standard legal document which is signed by the future husband in the presence of two witnesses before the wedding and given to the young wife during the ceremony. Written in Aramaic, this document enumerates the husband's obligations, especially financial, to his wife on a daily basis, and is the case in case there is a divorce. Just before the ceremony begins, the couple together signs the ketubah. Divorce or separation from the marriage covenant is a terrible thing. Any deviation from a thus saith the Lord is terrible. Mm-hmm. My brothers and sisters, it is a fearful thing to promise God that you or I are going to do something and then not do it. And yet many of us break the marriage covenant to the Lord, and the God that we serve comes back and writes and signs a new ketubah. Mm-hmm. In our text today, God writes promises to his ketubah. Your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a virgin, so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. Mm-hmm. In the early part of chapter 62 of Isaiah, God is promising this woman named Zion the assurance of Zion's salvation. Hear him say, for Zion's sake, I will not hold my peace. And for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her righteousness goes forth as brightness and her salvation as a lamp that burns. The Gentiles shall see your righteousness and all your kings of glory. You shall be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord will name. You shall also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no longer be termed forsaken, nor shall your land anymore be termed desolate. But you shall be called Hephzibah, and your land Beulah. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a virgin, so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. This, my brothers and sisters, is the ketubah. With all of these promises, Jesus continually makes to this woman a ketubah. And yet she still is distracted from the man that loves her. This woman is not trustworthy. This woman is fickle. This woman loves to run with other men. She can't seem to make up her mind whether she's going to serve God, her man. Rather, she is attracted to some kind of racial discriminatory politics, like systematic racism. She has supported a ruthless individual to preside over this democracy as a commander-in-chief. Her faith is sometimes up and sometimes down. And if God does not respond the way she likes, she seeks other methods. This is nothing more than unrequited love. There is nothing as bad as unrequited love. Jesus, at the time of this text, really wants to marry this woman, but she is so messed up in her head, she will not even sign the ketubah. Ezekiel writes of God's love for this woman in the 16th chapter, verse 6. He says, and I quote, "The word of the Lord came to me saying, son of man, cause Jerusalem to know her abominations and say, thus says the Lord God to Jerusalem, your birth and your nativity are from the land of Canaan. By your father was an Amorite, and your mother a Hittite. As for your nativity, on the day you were born, your navel cord was not cut, nor were you washed in water to cleanse you. You were not rubbed with salt, nor wrapped in swaddling clothes. No eye pitied you, to do any of these things for you, to have compassion on you. But you were thrown out in the open field when you yourself were loathed on the day you were born. And when I passed by you and saw you struggling in your own blood, I said to you in your blood, live. Yes, I said to you in your blood, live. I made you thrive like a plant in the field. You grew, matured, and became very beautiful. Your breasts were formed. Your hair grew, but you were naked and bare. When I passed you by again and looked at you, indeed your time was the time of love. So I spread my wings over you and covered your nakedness. Yes, I swore an oath to you and entered into a covenant with you, and you became mine, says the Lord God. Then I washed you in water. Yes, I thoroughly washed off your blood, and I anointed you with oil. I clothed you in embroidered cloth and gave you sandals of badger skin. I clothed you with fine linen and covered you with silk. I adorned you with ornaments, put a bracelet on your wrist and a chain around your neck. And I put a jewel in your nose, earrings in your ears, and a beautiful crown on your head. Verse 14, your fame went out among the nations because of your beauty, for it was perfect through my splendor, which I had bestowed on you, says the Lord God. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus Christ has signed his signature to the ketubah, but the woman is still fledgling. Some of the bridal party have not signed the ketubah. There is something about the church today. This woman wants Jesus, yet she is not willing to sign the ketubah. The woman thinks she has a marriage contract. Well, the question comes, how do you sign the ketubah? Well, firstly, we must remember the ketubah is not a contract, it is a covenant. Amen, somebody. Amen. Contracts are signed in ink, yes, as a temporary agreement. It can be broken, but covenants are signed in blood. Our text this morning says, for as a young man marries a virgin, so shall your sons marry you, And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. Mm-hmm. You cannot hang out in some kind of Switzerland and think just by chance you'll wind up in heaven. Mm-hmm. You think because your membership in the Seventh-day Adventist will guarantee you entrance into heaven? Not so. Mm-hmm. You think because you go to church on the seventh day that you got eternal life? Not so. Mm-hmm. You think if you can just get off caffeine that your name will automatically be written in the book of life? Mm-hmm. Not so. Mm-hmm. You think that your returning a faithful tithe is going to give you a passport into the pearly gates? God doesn't need your money. God's trying to get to your heart. Do you really think God is going to let you slide in without signing the ketubah? That is not signing the ketubah. You see, contracts again are signed in ink. They can be broken. They are contemporary. But the ketubah is signed in blood. In the Old Testament tradition, the man and the woman must consummate as one flesh together, as one body. Mm-hmm. The signing of the ketubah, the marriage vow, and the physical consummation must be legal. Yeah. The legal manifestation is a sheet with blood stain on it from the virgin, which is given to both fathers, the bride's father and the groom's father, who bear witness for the sheet with blood on it as confirmation that she is a virgin. Mm-hmm. If she is not a virgin, she can be stoned to death. That is why our key text says, for as a young man marries a virgin, mm-hmm. so shall your sons marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. Amen. Secondly, there are three ways to sign the ketubah. There are three ways to sign something. First, we can sign as a noun by using an object, quality, or an event whose presence or occurrence indicates the probable presence or occurrence of something. An example, the cross can be an object. Mm-hmm. I must love the cross by going near the cross. When I go near the cross, I'm in the cross. Mm-hmm. You see, the patibulum is the horizontal bar. It is a symbol of humanity. And then there is the stipe, the vertical bar, a symbol of God's divinity. Mm-hmm. There is no way of signing the ketubah without signing it in blood. Amen, somebody. Amen. It's got to have blood, for blood is permanent. Amen. A contract with ink will blot and it can be broken. The songwriter said, Jesus, keep me near the cross. There's a precious fountain. Free to all, a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. I must love the cross. Amen. You must love the cross. Yeah. The cross is not an X that's upside down, but the cross is two pieces of wood that Jesus was willing enough to sign his ketubah at Calvary for you and me.
Amen.
Oh, my brothers and sisters, we got to sign the ketubah. You see, the second way we can sign the ketubah is to sign it as a verb by using an object as one name, one's name. Mm-hmm. Jesus said, If anyone desire to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And he who does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. You got to sign the ketubah in blood by denying yourself. I've got to deny myself. We've got to deny ourselves physically. Mm-hmm. We've got to deny ourselves mentally. Yeah. We've got to deny ourselves spiritually and get our spirit out of the way, our spirituality out of the way, so that it is controlled by the spirituality of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Socially, we've got to deny ourselves. Intellectually, we've got to deny ourselves. For whoever desires to see his life or to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Mm-hmm. Denying self of self-congratulatory sitting around and doing nothing. Denying self of panting ourselves because we think we're all of that in the bag of chips. Mm-hmm. It ain't about us. Mm-hmm. It's about Jesus. Yes. Because we haven't signed the ketubah. Mm-hmm. Jesus signed the ketubah. Amen. The songwriter said, beneath the cross. Mm-hmm. You got to go beneath the cross. You just can't stare at the cross. Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand. The shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land, a home within the wilderness, a rest upon the way, from the burning of the noontime heat and the burden of the day. Thirdly, we can sign the tuber, and most importantly, as a gesture, by using a gesture to convey an idea or a command. Jesus said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, you got to sign the ketubah by getting wet with the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. I know that we take communion or do the Eucharist once a quarter, but my Bible says, as oft as you do this. The suggestion to me is that every time we have an opportunity to have communion, to drink his symbolic blood, to eat his symbolic body, we ought to do it. Somewhere I read where Ellen White says, we ought to take an hour every day and think about the terrible ordeal that Jesus did as our substitute, the shame he received hanging on the cross for you and me. And we can only take communion once a quarter? I think not. We got to drink the blood and eat the body, because salvation is not in works. It is in accepting the shameful death that Jesus endured for us. And every time we fast and subject ourselves to this, I believe that Jesus smiles.
Amen. Amen.
So my brothers and sisters, the songwriter said, thou dying lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God are saved to sin no more, are saved. To sin no more are saved to sin. No more till all the ransomed church of God are saved to sin no more. Oh, but there's some good news on the other side of the cross. I read in Revelation 16, 9 through 9, and these are the words, and I quote, "And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of my waters, and as the voice of a mighty thunderings, saying, Alleluia," mm-hmm. or black folks would say, "Hallelujah, mm-hmm. for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready." Oh, my brothers and sisters, I'm a part of this woman called the church. We got to be ready. "And saith unto me, Write, blessed are those which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. He is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful." But we got to write the ketubah. And if we write that ketubah, then we're going to be shedding our blood, amen. Hanging on our cross, yes. as we follow Jesus and his cross, yes. and his blood. Amen. You got to sign the ketubah. Mm. In closing, I want to say something to my lovely family here at 31st Street. You and I must sign the ketubah by becoming a new culture. You know, in Deuteronomy, the writer says, Moses tells the people that they can eat meat, but you can't eat the blood, mm-hmm. because the blood is life. And if we don't eat the blood and we carry out what God says do, we can become a new culture. What is culture? Culture is defined as learned patterns mm-hmm. of behaviors and values by a particular group. God wanted the children of Israel, before they crossed over into the new land of milk and honey, he wanted them to be a new culture. Mm-hmm. He wanted people to look at them mm-hmm. and see how they conduct themselves and want to know about this God they serve. Mm-hmm. I would say to you, my brothers and sisters here with 3-1, we have to become a new culture. Mm-hmm. We got to start carrying ourselves and showing up and being up and feeling up in order that men and women will look at us and think, well, these people that keep Saturday for Sunday, there's something good happening with them because they're always shining. They're always smiling. They're always up. Mm-hmm. There's something about the new culture. So I would say to you, my brothers and sisters, number one, men and women in this church must band together to ensure that the church runs like a well-oiled machine. Amen. Men and women must engage one another. And brothers, I don't mean no harm, but here lately I've been seeing a lot of ladies showing up, but I can't find the brethren. Mm-hmm. God created men to be there for women and created women to be there for men. Mm-hmm. So we got to start showing up. The second thing we got to do to sign this ketubah and create this new culture, the whole church, the entire church, must become a powerhouse of prayer. Amen. I've spent too much of my life saying a prayer, but not praying. See, one thing about prayer, you may not be on your knees. You can pray sitting at the red light. God hears your prayer. He wants us to have an attitude of prayer. There's nothing too big for God, 3-1. Amen. You now have the materials to go out here and meet men and women and sow seeds. Don't try to baptize them. We're not talking about baptizing. Just go out there and show some love. Mm-hmm. And they will respond to you. You don't have to wait for the pastor to tell you or suggest to you, we need to go out and do some creative outreach. As a matter of fact, remember, this is your church.
Amen.
I'm going to say this in the front of Elder Edwards because he knows my heart. Stop waiting on the pastor. Stop looking for a pastor. This is your church. Pastors come and go. God is not going to blame the pastor or get you off the hook because you don't have a pastor. You got to pastor yourself under the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And when the pastor comes, you support the pastor. You love the pastor because the pastor brings something unique to the body of Christ.
Amen.
That's another way of signing the ketubah. And last but not least, you got to love each other, even though you may not like each other. Thank God that Jesus didn't say we had to like everybody, but he said we got to love everybody. The problem with most of us, a lot of people get in trouble and get married to somebody they like, and they misconstrue what love is. Calling love like and like love, and 90 days after it's over, they're gone. I say to you in closing that when we sign the ketubah, when our life is a life of signing the ketubah, all you got to do is ask the Holy Spirit, come inside of me, Lord. Remove my vanity. Give me the humanity through the Holy Spirit. That when it's time for me to speak up, I can speak up. When it's time for me to shut up, I can shut up. Just let the Holy Spirit shine through us. And I promise you, if we will live every day signing the ketubah, we will be ready when those clouds open up and the holy city comes down with the gates open. We will be able to say, lo, this is our God.
Amen.
We have waited for him and he will save us.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you. Thank you, dear God, for speaking to us about the permanence of blood and bringing us back to the most important, for want of a better word, liquid in the world, in the universe, was the blood that Jesus Christ shed for us. And dear Lord, may we be willing and ready to shed blood. And again, may your Holy Spirit flash through us and people be gripped because of the Holy Spirit that keeps us signing the ketubah all through the day. This is our prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ, that everyone say amen.
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 And amen.
Amen. Amen.
And now, my brothers and sisters, it's that time again, Christmas on Sabbath. And we see where Elder Belinda has got some news for you. You don't need a Christmas tree. Just listen closely to what she says, and you will be blessed. Elder Belinda, I give it to you.
Thank you so much, Pastor. Thank you. I am pleased today to be able to share our weekly updates and just want to say thank you so much, Pastor Kilby, for telling us about the ketubah. We may not have known what the ketubah was, but now we do. And so let me just say to you all and ask you this question. Are you glad that the ketubah is signed in blood? I know I am. And I think about that song. As soon as you said it and described it, Pastor Kilby, I went to a communion service. When we sing that song, I know it was the blood. And I know it was the blood in my life. And I'm sure for each of you today, you are too saying that you know it was the blood. And so we just thank God for the ketubah, the signing of the ketubah. He signed it with his own blood. And so we are indeed grateful. Thank you, Pastor Kilby, for that. As you know, today we are celebrating the pastoral ministry of Pastor and Sister Kilby. And not only are we celebrating it today, hearing this message, but we are celebrating it with a parking lot farewell. And so today, everyone, from 1 to 2:30 p.m., we want you to be able to come by and to say goodbye to Pastor and Sister Kilby in person in the parking lot. And so a nice event has been created in a beautiful and socially distant way, but yet still in person. And it's just going to give everyone an opportunity to personally give farewells and love and air hugs to both of them. And so we want you all to just continue to keep them safe, not only in your prayers, but physically today when we have this farewell. So please remember that masks will be required at all times. And we want you to plan to greet them individually or in small family groups. And so with that, we ask you to please spend no more than a max of 10 minutes with them so that everybody will get a chance to greet Pastor and Sister Kilby. So don't go beyond the roped off areas. And we know it's going to be hard for them too to stay contained, but we are just wanting everyone to stay safe. So please plan to share your love. You've got plenty of time. It's only 12:08 right now. And the celebration will start right about 1 o'clock and go until 2:30. And so we just want to invite you out today to be able to do that so that you can celebrate in person with the Kilbys. Now, we also know that while this has been pandemic and things are a bit restrictive, we want you to stay tuned for a formal farewell. And that's going to be at a later date, but we're going to be able to get you details on that. So just stay tuned for that at a later date. Also, we want to invite you to be able to mail, if you can't make it out today, that you can mail your gifts and cards directly to the Kilbys. And we want to make that easy for you and for them. And so I provided here their address, which is 11323 Riverleaf Drive in Riverside, California, 92505. And so please just be sure that if you can't get here today, send some love their way through a card or a gift that you might want to give. And then we will be able to share that love and then send them with real token of our appreciation for their ministry to us at 31st Street. I want to invite you to know that the food box distribution is going to continue. It is scheduled for the next set of dates in the month of April, April 13. And then we want to make sure that you get out to help us with volunteerism. You'll see that we do have lots and lots of things that are coming. And so we'll do the distribution on a Tuesday and then packaging on Tuesday and then distribution on Wednesdays. So please, if you can't use the items yourself, please make sure that you invite someone else to participate and get a box for a neighbor or a friend or somebody that's in need. You know, in our church family, you heard Elder Al pray for the list of those that are bereaved and those that are sick and shut in, but we want to just continue to lift up all of our church family who has lost loved ones. We know that Elder Brown lost her sister and then also her daughter-in-law. And then we want to continue to support Sister Bryant with the loss of her niece, Janice Grant. And then also continue to keep in our prayers Brother Rico Moore, who lost his mother and has made it back from Arizona. So we know that we do have so many bereaved families, but guess what we can do? We can be active in prayer. And so we just invite you to do that. So I'll conclude today before I hand it back to Pastor Kilby to just let them know from me and from our church family that goodbyes are not forever. Goodbyes are not the end. They simply mean we'll miss you until we see you again. So Pastor Kilby, we and Sister Kilby, we know that this is not goodbye. It's just see you later. We'll see you later. We know you're just up the road, and we'll continue to love on you from afar. So I just want to turn it back to you for our benediction today.
Thank you, Elder Belinda. Thank you for those kind words. Thank you, church family. Mm-hmm. And now let us have our benediction. I want to close out with those famous words found in Jude 14, verses 24 through 25. Now, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Let the church say amen.
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 Yeah. Happy Sabbath to you, my brothers and sisters.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. God bless you. God bless you.
Love you. Thank you.
Thank you, Joey. We appreciate your ministry.
Thank you.
Aloha. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Good word, man.
Bless the Lord, too.
Hi, Janie. Liz.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, everyone.
To you as well. Thank you, Dietra. Thank you, Elder Powell. And thank you, Joe, and everyone for your participation.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.